little recapitulate the whatever we have done. This is, you all know the alphabet. Basically, alphabet, it should be finite. There may be typical question, it can be infinite or not. This is alphabet, it may consist of a single terminal also, say A only. Then A language can be infinite, maybe A square, all these things. Language may be infinite. So, alphabet can be finite, but language can be infinite. That is great. Sentences, you know, all you know, but there is a subtle difference between English language and our formal language. There is the concept of word here. Okay, here the terminals and sentence, no concept of word. Okay, so that's it. Maybe in programming language you see if then else, that if then we are taken as a terminal. Okay, if within angled bracket it is taken as a terminal, if then else is a kind of a terminal. It is, that is not a word. The etcs you all know. Now this slide is little bit, you all know everything, but I found it and interesting. What is empty string? See, it is empty string and shy, all of you know, but let's be repeat. It is useful to introduce the concept of empty or null, denoted by Greek epsilon. This is the epsilon. In some books, say lambda is there. Better you follow the Greek epsilon. Most of the good books go for epsilon. This is the symbol. The only string satisfying the identity, that is no other string. X is another terminal. X epsilon, X is a string, or epsilon X is equal to X. So this is the, like, identity matrix. Like whenever you I matrix, you multiply it after or before, it becomes the same. So this epsilon is, you take it as an example. If your matrix multiplication, it is not a zero, it is not one, it is kind of an identity matrix. And but the length is catch is the length is zero. And another thing is empty string should not be, sorry, the empty string should not be confused with empty set. That is a totally different concept. In fact, shy, it is called Greek shy, as a language which contains no string. Okay, whereas this means contains one string, that is an empty string. So though it is length is zero, a language can have empty string. What does it mean? That means its starting state is an initial state. That is called, that language accepts a empty string. If the starting state is not initial state, any finite automata, any deterministic finite automata or Poisson automata, then language doesn't accept empty string. That's it. So if the language accepts empty string, that means language accepts this thing, that is different than shy. Shy means language doesn't accept any string. Can find out what a language doesn't accept any string. Language is shy. You can have rules. You can have rules, but there is no sentences coming out. So the rules are such a way that it doesn't come with its terminals. All kind of terminals, then you got a valid sentence. You may have S rule, S start variable, P production rules. Then you call the language is shy. But language contains epsilon. Means great. It means language accepts the language epsilon string. And you know, the generally we do not accept. Right now, we all know the only start variable will take an epsilon, no other. So if it is, that is we got it from conversion from any context-free grammar to Chomsky's normal form conversion. We see that it can, if any variable goes to epsilon, that can be come to the shift to a start variable, or a new start variable go to epsilon. So we do not want any variable, any other than start variable go to epsilon. Why? The reason is simple. If you can allow any other variable to epsilon, then you put it in the right hand side, on your rule, the length of the right hand side can be less than length of the left hand side. Then it violates the type 1, type 2, type 3 grammar. only type 0 grammar, your length of right hand side can be less than length of left hand side. But exception is the rule, only one exception we allow, that is start variable goes to epsilon. If you take the rule start variable to epsilon, mod of AC is 1 and mod of epsilon you know 0, that is allowed for type 3 language, type 2 language and type 1 language. But if you allow any other variable to go to epsilon, then it might come out as a rule so that it will go to type 0 grammar. And type 0 grammar, you know the parsing is almost impossible. So that is the type 0 grammar is for our interest. Yeah, it is the boundaries of computer science's most interesting area, like our space. We discover the galaxies and all these things, but yeah, that maybe in one day it will be practical, but right now the most interest is our regular language. Regular language is very fundamental for naming your integer, floating point numbers. That is done by regular expression, but unfortunately you cannot do program only through the regular language. What is the reason? You know that regular language cannot be pumped, regular language cannot be called by function, regular language doesn't support opening braces and matching closing braces, so that you cannot call again and again. So you need a deterministic context free grammar. And one good point about a deterministic context free grammar, example you all know, a to the power n, b to the power n, and always balance parenthesis and expression grammar. Expression grammar means you have left hand side e, right hand side e plus t, not e plus e. If e plus e, then it will create an ambiguity, because we know our star evaluation should be, multiplication evaluation should be done first, then the addition. So we create another rule, t is equal to t star e, like so that you can your multiplication can be more highlighted. So that is called expression grammar. So all these grammars can be proven as a deterministic context-free grammar. And good point of view, you can have a deterministic context-free grammar, unambiguous grammar. And all deterministic context-free grammar can be have unambiguous grammar. You have to find it. Like expression grammar, we can little change here by rules, tweaking the rules, you can get a unambiguous grammar. And unambiguous grammar, you can have a deterministic PDA machine. But if you take the palindrome grammar, then it is a thing that non-deterministic PDA, the power is more. Achha, then you come to a little bit confusion. What is power of a machine? Power of a machine means, see, we see the power of a machine of non-deterministic finite automata and deterministic finite automata same. Why? But it cannot be, you know, if we can realize a non-deterministic finite automata by, you have a plenty of resistors and transistors and IC, so we can create the machines at a time and all, you can make it faster. Yes, it can be, theoretically can be made faster by non-deterministic finite automata, but it is not a preferred choice, because if you create such machine, that will create heat and all these things, and that is not good. So in all computer science, we see we do not go hitchhike policy. Like we human being, we always do hitchhike. We try to do, if it not fails, it go other, because we don't have that time constriction. But in computer science, most of the problem we try to solve in a deterministic way. That means it goes and it must solve. If it doesn't solve, it's a failure. So though we have if-then-else structure, but yeah, that is for limited use. If you go searching and searching and searching, it will never halt like Turing machine. So what we are here, what is the power of a machine? Power of a machine means whether it can understand any extra language. Like deterministic PDA cannot understand the palindrome language. So, but non-deterministic PDA by luck, it can accept a palindrome language. So that then we say the non-deterministic PDA has more power. That is the concept of more power. And we'll find the Turing machine has, and non-deterministic Turing machine has the same power. That is great, and that is little bit confusing also. See, your deterministic finite automata and non-deterministic finite automata have same power, because non-deterministic finite automata cannot accept any single language mode. Okay, that is the reason the same power. But we found it non-deterministic PDA can understand palindrome by sheer luck, by taking a chance. If one, then it has more power than deterministic PDA. But unfortunately, non-deterministic PDA accept non-deterministic CFG, and most of the grammars are ambiguous. And because it's ambiguous grammar, you cannot run program on it. You cannot do program on it. So your program will be ambiguous. So then come another part we always miss. See, in our lectures, we all see. I have mentioned certain lectures in context-sensitive grammar, that is, which is done by linear bounded automata. But it is in literature, you see, we have a hardly chapter. So the linear bounded automata is nothing but a Turing machine bounded on both sides. So, and then come the type zero grammar. This it. So what are the things we have discussed today? That empty string, this is the classical thing of empty string. It is like a identity matrix, and shy, it is different. You all know, just we this thing. Another concept is reverse, that is, say, it is a string reverse to amount. You also know that one fantastic rule of this: if you see it both string x and y, and if you go reverse, and it is basically y and x. So you all know, but you have to be careful about it. And epsilon r is epsilon, that is a great thing. What we have discussed till now, that deterministic Turing machine and non-deterministic Turing machine has same power. What is my power? Power doesn't mean it does quickly or not. That is not the power. Or on electricity, say power means it is a 1 watt or 2 watt. That is not the power concept here. Here the power in automata means whether it can understand any extra language. Like non-deterministic PDA can understand a to the power n, b to the power n also, and also palindrome. So that is the reason we say non-deterministic PDA can have extra power. But non-deterministic Turing machine doesn't have any extra power. That's great. And another thing we'll prove, and that is that deterministic Turing machine, if you have a multiple head, multiple, then also it doesn't add any power. But it might be done quickly. It might be done quickly, but that doesn't mean power. Power means if we can attach a multiple tape, can it understand a which is not understandable? Because we Turing machine, we know there are two kinds of problems. One is Turing decidable problems. That means Turing can always say, yeah, it can be done. And another time say, Turing sometimes say, yes, it can be done, but if it cannot be done, I am helpless. That is called Turing recognizable problem. That is Turing decidable problem. The language is recursive language, and Turing recognizable is language is called recursively enumerable language. More tougher. So today we try with some examples of Turing machine. Again, we revisit our Turing machine. Another interesting concept of why you're bothered about string. Why so string? So everywhere, if you go to computer science, anywhere you go for string. See, only C, because at that time Dennis Ritchie have developed that C. C has concept of string, doesn't have concept of string. Is a character arrays, but you see all subsequent languages like Java 1990 onwards or Python developed in 1990 onwards, they all maintain a string. String is kind of an immutable thing, so you cannot change it, because whenever it makes it immutable, that means it can manipulate it much faster. In traditional C, that is one negative point of C, that is C is a character array. And it cannot be moved efficiently enough. That is thing. And another, why a string? Because every problem can be denoted by a string. See, in our English language, we can denote it a string. Even a picture can be understood by a computer vision problem by a string of understanding. Any graphical problem can be understood by a string. A string can consist of all the graph nodes and connectivity. So that is the hard fact of the truth. That is the great thing of the string, that string can, you can put your problem See, you can put your problem in a computer graphics or the, everything can be put to a string. So that is great. So string is very important. Okay, is the chapter 3, Charge Turing thesis. Alan Turing does his PhD thesis under Charge. Alan's a Charge in Princeton, and the great thing about it, I just go to a one purple slide. This is a start with David Hilbert. I know whether you have heard it. David is a great mathematician, one of the best mathematician in 19th century. He in 1900 he comes out with a conference, that is famous 1900 mathematical conference. He comes up with 23 problems, that the 23 problems the mathematician should discuss, and it is difficult at that time. Now some of them have solved, some of them not yet solved, but Turing is attracted to one problem. Like Hilbert said, can every problem can be solved by a mechanical procedure? Turing says, no, there exists no computer, there exists a concept. Before that, nobody said that. So Turing, the first person on earth, said not all problems can be solved by a machine. That is the concept of no algorithm problem. Okay, that is the first concept Turing comes in. This is the thing. Yeah, this is a hard problem. This is the, what is the hard problem? This is a Hilbert 10 problem. It's a typical equation. Say x plus 2y squared, whether there is a integer root or not. So that we can easily find it out. Yeah, 0, 0 can be a root. Okay, but say this kind of problem, whether they have the integer root or not. So these problems are typically undecidable. So let's see. These are called Diophantine equation. We'll go to little bit. This problem is solved by 1970 one Russian scientist, and they say it cannot be done. That is a concept. Sometimes it can be done, and sometimes it cannot be done. So then that is the concept of the Turing recognizable comes. Let's see. And Turing has said it in 1936. And at that time, remember, no finite state machine has, and finite state machine was there, but all these properties and all these things not covered very detailed, and another is pushed down. Definitely PDA is not there at that time, Turing concept, but one great thing about Turing machine is it doesn't need PDA, it can solve all the problems. But we have found that PDA can also is very powerful, say, but PDA cannot solve the X, WW problem, but Turing machine can solve a to the power n, b to the power n also, and WW problem also. So that is a Turing machine is much more powerful. So this is Hilbert 10th problem. That is a starter. Say this is a equation 15x squared 23j 25y. These are called coefficient. You all know it's a coefficient, and these are the variables x squared, z. And this is a polynomial equation. Yes, because variables are here, and but it may have some. So does it have any integer root or not? Sometimes you can find, sometimes it cannot find. It took 21 years, 4 years to solve that, it cannot be done. So this kind of polynomial, Hilbert asks at the time, there must be some method. Hilbert don't mention the algorithm. Algorithm terms came later. It was, is there any solve? A finite number of steps are there which can solve the problem. So this is the person, Mathieu Vichy solved it in 1970, that it is impossible. But Turing has predicted that in 1936. So the 10th problem, it is basically Turing recognizable problem. In certain time, the Turing machine, if you give a Turing machine a Diophantine equation, if it is the solution is there, Turing machine will find it definitely. If it is not, Turing machine will not halt. That is the trademark concept of Turing recognizable machine. What is Turing machine doesn't halt? That is, if the Turing, it at every case Turing machine doesn't halt, that means no algorithm. Okay, but if Turing machine sometimes halt, sometimes doesn't halt, if the solution is found for this Diophantine equation, sometimes it can be found, then Turing machine halts, and sometimes it will go forever doesn't hold, then that is a typical case of Turing recognizable. What is the difference between Turing decidable and Turing recognizable? Turing decidable problems, Turing machine will always hold. Always hold. Accept, reject, or always hold. 100% hold. And what is Turing recognizable? Sometimes it holds with solution, sometimes it not. So that is that Turing machine. 1936 Turing developed that a simple machine, theoretical machine, that whether there is an algorithm, what the thing is solved, whether there is an algorithm, the algorithm, if there is no algorithm, you cannot program Turing machine. If some algorithms are there which may not halt Turing machine and sometimes halt, that is called Turing recognizable machine. But that is that machine, that Turing recognizable language or problems, this sometimes you see, I mean, sometimes it's a problem, sometimes a language, they are same, they are equivalent. So Turing recognizable definitely tougher than Turing decidable, but there are more problems are there or languages are there which is not Turing recognizable also. Okay, that is, these are the really hard problems. We call it hard problems, NP complete problems, NP problems. This called, one of the features of the NP complete problem, I'll give you an example. It is very tough to get the NP solution to the forward way, but if you are given a solution, you just check it by putting this whether it solve or not. That is the earmark of the NP complete problem. NP complete problem means it cannot be found solution, but if you can copy it somewhere, you can hunch it, it might be, if you try it, then it can solve. Sometimes we solve our problems, say our Sudoku, we try and match time, sometimes it matches. These are the examples of the hard problems. You cannot write a full-fledged algorithm to solve. You can, but it takes amount of time. So that is called if you match it, you sometimes get it. Any question, you can say that is a Turing recognizable. So this is the Church-Turing thesis, Church's guide 36. If L is recognized by a program for some computer, L is recognized by Turing machine. So 23 Hilbert problems. I say, what are the Hilbert problems? The 10th problem is very interesting for computer science because Turing attacked that problem and solve it with his PhD supervisor, Alan Church in Princeton University. That, and Alan Church, his guide is also differentiated another way, the lambda calculus, more theoretical. But why there are several methods that they are at a time within 1 or 2 years have developed. But Turing machine is very practical and you can make a computer out of it and everything. That is the reason the Turing machine is so good. Because they learn automata. Because that is the fundamental block of computer science. Whole computer science is automata, data structure, algorithm. And you cannot do a program if you cannot understand automata, if you cannot understand data structure, algorithm, if you don't know complexity, algorithmic complexity. When the complexity is tractable, intractable, then intractable, certain things are very hard problem. Then how to solve this hard problem by approximation algorithm? Probably you are in data structure algorithm class are covering. If there is like traveling salesman problem, TSP problem, say short, or that is a Hamiltonian circuit problem. So you have to approximate that. So you have to learn automata. Yeah, this is the Church-Turing thesis that Turing 1936 he devised a simple machine. Not, it is all theoretical. A paper strip, a finite state machine can go one step left, one step right. It can solve any algorithm. That is great. Before that, hardly any concept of algorithm. Okay, maybe 300 BC, the Greek knows the how to GCD, great GCD calculation. Certain people know certain things. The concept of algorithm, computability, all these things come from this seminal work of Alan Turing. So that is great. So you should read and get more interesting. And another most interesting about the Turing machine is, sometimes, though I do not believe in this Ramayana Mahabharata personally. So these are I for me it's like is a great novel. But I do not know whether it has happened or not, Ajodhya and all these things. But okay, it is not a political. But what's your Ramayana? It is said Ramayana was written before Ram born. I think you have all heard that is great poet Valmiki. He wrote a novel before Ram, and Ram came and do this. Turing machine does the same thing. So Turing machine, 1936, he wrote a paper. At that time, no computer, nothing, no finalistic machine. And then the whole computer science starts from this seminal work, and this all definitions of finite state machine, Moore machine, Mealy machine develops in 1940s and 50s, and then the Pulsion automata in 1950s, and more advanced and all these things. Then Noam Chomsky came, his work in 1957, he actually gave a tremendous work like Alan Turing from the linguistic front of view. He developed that all languages, say we speak English, Bengali, Tamil, Japanese, Chinese and all these things. The child learns a language not from the grammar book, not Renan Martin book. Any child, generally, it has been found that in humankind that all humans generally start speaking two and a half years old. So at that time, child can learn from his parents and nearabouts repeated sentence the grammar. The child learns, then that grammar it helps to speak. Here I have some doubt about, obviously, in our Bengali this culture. So we generally talk by relations. So we talk father, mother, and other relations, didi, dada, and all this. That is very confusing for child. So that way, maybe the British are more better. They always ask the people by common name, their proper name, sorry, the proper name, Bob, Mary, and all that. That helps the child. Whenever the child, then he can ask, everybody calls his father Bob, he can also ask Bob. So that is great. And there is famous joke, say, in Gopal Bhar joke, in a market, Gopal Bhar is lost his child. Then his child calls Gopal, Gopal, then Gopal came and rebukes, why you call my name? Then the child, Gopalbhar's child, is equally brilliant. He said, if I ask Baba, Baba, then every Baba will look at me. So it's better to call the proper name. So that is a great. So what are you talking? What the thing is that our linguist Noam Chomsky, he's still 93, is a brilliant. So he got Alan Turing Award and all these things. He developed the languages. He found that all basically languages, except a few, maybe certain primitive languages, they are not that. All languages can form sentences. Maybe our whales and dolphins, they also, with the sound wave generated, they can also make a sentence. With various sound waves, they can make understandable sentences so that dolphin can understand. Dolphin and whales or elephants, they can speak. Okay. Definitely, if they can speak, definitely there's some language, there are some terminals and concept. First Noam Chomsky developed, and then he keep on developing this regular grammar, type 3 grammar, type 1 grammar. Everything is done single-handedly by Noam Chomsky. Type 2 grammar, context-free, two deterministic context-free, non-deterministic context-free, context-sensitive, type 0 grammar. And this all match to the Turing machine. Turing machine solve all the problem. Only exception in type 0. In the type 0 language, the decidable portion Turing solve, and recognizable, so Turing solves certain problems, certain terms it cannot, it doesn't hold. That is an example of Turing recognizable problem. So these things, this you read this chapter, I have already covered this chapter from the Michael Sipser book. This is very interesting. They use this a blank character. This is the main characteristic of Turing machine. Turing machine can both write on tape and read from it. There is one great similarity with Turing machine with one finite state machine, that is Mealy machine, not Moore. I found that though Mille machine is faster, that you all know, and Moon machine, one negative thing is Moon machine gives output plus one, because Moon machine always give record after one cycle, but Moon machine is stable, and Moon machine may contains more circuits, transistors and all. But Mille machine, one great thing is, for every transition, Mille machine gives output. You think that Mille machine gives output on a tape, same as a Turing machine. So there is only Mille machine and Moore machine somewhat, but Moore machine gives output after one clock state. So it is better we concept the Mille machine. So Mille machine and Turing machine, one similarity is it writes something. Your PDA doesn't write something. So it accept or reject. It accept, but it is a stupid thing, because if it accepts, say in what is happened in whenever in syntax analysis in compiler, we put a string and then it accepts, then again you have to run this string by another differently configured PDA machine to get this parsing tree. Then it writes it. The parsing tree is written in a memory. How it is written, that you know the algorithm and class, that you, how can you write a pointer structure, a linked list, double linked list. It basically it can be double linked list, or it can be hash table. It can be, I know you probably know the hash table. In Python, you know the dictionary concept is there. That is basically a hash table. So your in that stage, it a machine puts in the your all the symbols in the storage, and also the parsing tree. You know the parsing tree should be unique from left to right or right to left. So there should be one and only parsing tree, but that is the output of the PDA, and then it is useful. Otherwise, accepts or rejects, okay, it accepts, then it's, but one great thing in Mille machine, it always writes output in another tape. Concept is here in Turing machine, in a single tape, it writes it output, maybe in separate spaces, and that is great. So, and one great concept or another is universal Turing machine. It reads input, sometimes it reads input and go left to right, left to right, left to right, and it reads some 10 symbols, and these 10 symbols change the finite state machine behavior. It is a great concept. Like you give a string of information so that it changes the configuration of the finite state machine. That is the program. Then it this string called program, and we can find that for all such problems, if you have an algorithm, then we can program this Turing machine to solve those. It might take longer because it takes only one step at a time, rate life, but it will eventually solve, and it will halt definitely. Then we have, so there is an algorithm, any algorithm, in Diophantine equation is simple. But why I give an example Diophantine equation, why I'm not taking ax square minus bx plus c, b square minus 4 square 2a, because it is a real, it is a real number. But for if you find it, oh, ax square bx plus c must have integer solution, it might or might not be. And you try with some values, integer can be negative also. So if it's a big polynomial equation with several variables, x, y, z, and with some, then it will be a hard problem, very hard problem. You have to try again and again. There may be integer solution, there might not be integer solution. So that is proved by this 1970 only, that it cannot be done. But Turing visualizes, it is a case of Turing, not Turing decidable, Turing recognizable problem. If it is a solution is there, it will find it. If it is not there, Turing machine should have halt and say, no, I cannot. No, it cannot. It halt. It never loops. That is the hallmark of Turing recognizable. Okay. So please, these portions, because I have already done it, please see Michael Sifson's book. Is the best book in the Turing machine, and all others, if you have, okay, all the best.